The views expressed on this program are not necessarily the views of Lexington Community Radio or its board of directors. The views expressed are solely those of the programmers.
You are listening to Off the Cuff. Now, here's your host, Adam Banks.
Welcome, everybody, to Off the Cuff. I am Adam Banks coming at you live from Lexington, Kentucky. Thank you for listening to the show, and thank you for tuning in to WLXU 93.9 FM. In addition to listening to us on the radio, you can check out our Facebook live stream at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, or you can download the Radio Lex app on your smartphone device to listen anywhere in the entire country. I am broadcasting from the WLXU studios here in Lexington, and Amber Turner, my co-host, is broadcasting from her home in Lexington. Amber, how are you? Well, in order for the audience to hear you, you got to take your microphone off mute.
That's my first Zoom foul, but I'm doing great. It's Thursday, talking to you. How are you doing?
I'm doing fantastic. And Amber, I just want to announce, everybody knows that we've been on Facebook for a long time, since the beginning, since March of 2014. You can follow Off the Cuff at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. But now, if you are on the gram, you can now follow Off the Cuff on Instagram because we are on there. Same handle, Off the Cuff with Adam Banks, and you can follow us on Instagram. I've been sending out follow invites, or how does that work? You follow people in the hopes of they follow you back.
I think that's what it is, bulk following in the hopes of a few back.
Yes, but we are on Insta, so very excited to let everybody know that. But I want to start off the show, Amber, talking about the first presidential debate that happened on Tuesday. And the debate is something that the entire world watches. It's not just the country, because the entire world is watching two people debate over topics because it's a big deal, because one of those two men is going to be elected president or reelected president. And the president of the United States is the leader of the free world. So therefore, the whole entire world wants to watch the presidential debate. It was a lot of name calling, a lot of bitter exchanges happened there. The topics included the Supreme Court, the economy, the coronavirus pandemic, and lots more. But did you get a chance to watch the debate?
I'm going to say, unfortunately, I did.
it was something else. It was literally, you could tell that it was two men on that stage that genuinely did not like each other.
I think there was a lot of animosity, and I knew if I could cut the tension with a butter knife at the house, I could only imagine what it was like there.
The moderator was Chris Wallace. He is an anchor on Fox News. He struggled to maintain control during the debate. A lot of people were saying, well, what was Chris Wallace supposed to do? Because when you've got a man like Donald Trump interrupting every other word, what is he supposed to do? Well, he's the moderator. The moderator is supposed to take control. I think I give Chris Wallace an F on his moderation of the moderating
just
the debate. Just a straight F. Dude, look, if Joe Biden can sit there and say man every other word too, I can say dude on the radio.
But oh yeah,
but
go with it.
Dude, Chris Wallace, if you are going to be the moderator and you are going against somebody with the dominance of Donald Trump, you have to be more dominant than him during that debate. You're the moderator. But Donald Trump, of course, took control of the debate. And in return, I think that only hurt himself, because Donald would not shut up. And I don't understand why he wouldn't let Joe Biden speak. It was like when Joe Biden was asked a question, Trump, it was like he just didn't know how to allow anyone else to have fair, equal time to speak. And I think in return that hurt him, Amber.
Well, I just think there's so much disdain between the two of them that it's kind of like, don't you remember when you and your sister would fight and your mom would try to get her side of the story?
Yeah.
Absolutely did not want her to tell her side.
Right.
Like, that's exactly how I felt this entire debate. Like, somebody's telling on somebody.
Trump, he definitely needed to get a grip and maintain control of the debate. Too much dominance is annoying. And I think that dominance is something that the president of the United States should have. But when somebody is showing too much dominance, it's just annoying. And
it's disrespectful.
And it's very disrespectful. And it was hard to get through. I will say that. Now, I'm not going to sit there and say that Joe Biden did a fantastic job. They both did not accomplish anything. I am really surprised that Joe Biden was able to keep his stamina up for 90 minutes. To stand there and be as sharp as he was for the 90 minutes that he did debate, I'm surprised that he was able to do it without messing up. But Amber, if Trump would have shut up and let Donald Trump, or if Trump would have just hushed and let Biden speak, Biden would have eventually put his foot in his mouth.
Oh, yeah. But here it is. Like, in 2020, did you really think that we would hear our sitting president and almost potential president looking at each other and saying, shut up, man? Did you really think that's what we would hear in 2020? Shut up, man. That's where we've made it.
Well, Biden comes out. He comes out and he's like, how you doing, man? Right when he first walks out on stage, he's like, how you doing, man? That sounds like two guys in high school seeing each other after a long summer break.
Well, I mean, I'm sure they've encountered each other a lot, and Joe Biden knew what he was stepping into. He knew he was stepping into the lion's den. I think everybody knew that. So I feel like he came out with the best of spirits, maybe best of intentions.
Here are the takeaways that I have from the debate. These are just the main things that I feel like that stood out to a lot of the American people. The first thing is Trump declining to condemn white supremacist groups and that right there in 2020, Trump, why don't you condemn white supremacy and a white supremacist? Right now, I will say that I condemn it. Why can't our president say it? And it's just, to me, that stood out. I think that hurt him. His response to the coronavirus pandemic that claimed more than 200,000 American lives, he said that he's done a great job with the pandemic. I don't really know what he could have done any different. I really don't. So I don't think that him saying that actually hurt him, but I don't necessarily think that saying it was a good job is the best thing to say. Another thing that stood out to me in this debate was the part where Donald Trump said, did you just use the word smart when he looked at Joe Biden? Because the president asked Biden that question. He said, did you just use the word smart? Because he said, quote, to Joe Biden, he said, you graduated either the lowest or almost the lowest in your class. Don't ever use the word smart with me, Joe. So, again, high schoolers fighting. And Biden, this stood out to me. For his part, he tried to direct his answers to the audience watching at home. He liked to stare into the camera a lot. Mm-hmm. And you know it was a move that his team told him to do. It was so scripted. Because Joe Biden, I feel like, was definitely instructed to look at the camera to make it more personable. I'm a speech instructor. I know what it takes to be personable with your audience. I know what he's doing. I studied debates. And debating is just a fascinating thing just to even have, because do you know why we even have presidential debates, Amber?
You know what? Why don't you go ahead and tell us?
Well, it was born out of a series for the senator race. It was between Abraham Lincoln and Stephen Douglas in the 1800s. They were running for senator of Illinois, and Abraham Lincoln was going around saying what he was going to do for the country, and Stephen Douglas was like, hey, where's my fair time to go around and say what I'm going to do? So they actually set up a series of debates, and they kind of went against each other, and it caught on, and now it's something that's just caught on nationally, and we've been debating ever since. And the first televised debate, because debates have changed throughout the years, but the first televised debate was between John F. Kennedy and Richard Nixon in 1960.
And that would be a good one to go back and watch if there's footage from it.
I'm serious. It is a debate that you want to go back and watch. And there is footage of it. You can go on YouTube. And what's interesting about that debate, even though it is the first television debate, see, these candidates had no idea what and how powerful TV is in 1960. Mm-hmm. They really didn't have a clue of how much power that could give them if they debate on TV. Because back in the day, you just debated on the radio, or you just debated with nobody really seeing you like the worldwide worldwide like television can do for people. Mm-hmm. But when that debate happened in 1960, Nixon is a man's man. So he refused to wear makeup. And he sweated like crazy under those lights. But John F. Kennedy said, no, put all the makeup you want on me. And they put it all on him. They caked it on him. And who do you think looked better on camera, Kennedy or Nixon?
Well, I mean, Kennedy was very attractive anyway, so I'm going to go with him regardless, but I'm going to still pick him.
Well, the audience actually favored more towards Kennedy after that debate, and before the debate started, Nixon was winning by a huge margin. But after the first televised debate, when everybody seen what Kennedy looked like, and they seen how smooth and suave he was, and they could put a face to the politician, then they were like, okay, this is who I want as my president. So the television debates really do have power. I guarantee you there were some people that did not know who they were voting for, and they were waiting for the televised debate to make that decision.
I guarantee that, because I feel like I am definitely one of those people right now.
One of my thesis papers in graduate school when I was studying communication was the symbolic interpretivism theory, which is a theory that talks about the characteristics that make up us, like our gender, our height, our weight, how things like that. And I was saying that because of our symbolic interpretivism characteristics that we have, those are the things that people look at when voting for a candidate. Not necessarily how they are on their policies, but they're going to vote for maybe the better looking candidate, or the candidate that looks to be in better shape, or the candidate just because he's a man versus a woman, or just because he's white versus black. So I was saying that those characteristics is the majority of the reason why people vote for the candidate.
Yes, I can agree with that. I can. You will gravitate towards people that you feel like you are compatible with, that you could have things in common with, because you don't want to vote for somebody that you have absolutely nothing in common with, because obviously they're not going to have any of the same stances you do. So, I mean, I can wholeheartedly agree with that.
It looks like that what goes into making a debate or having a presidential debate, the reason why you don't really see it in small towns is because there is some strict rules when setting up a presidential debate. The first rule is that it has to be able to air condition 15,000 square feet, and it needs to be able to have at least 3,000 available hotel rooms around the venue. So a lot of small towns can't host the debate because of that, and a lot of universities just say, hey, we'll do it. But I think there was a debate, a vice presidential debate at Center College a couple years ago with Sarah Palin and somebody else.
I'm not sure about that.
Yeah, or it might have been Joe Biden and Paul Ryan, actually. But yeah, they were at Center College. Pretty interesting. But that is the first debate. It is over with. There are two left. The next one is on October the 15th. And the next debate, I'm not for sure what the format of this debate is. I know the first debate was just the moderator and the candidates. And then the next two debates, it's either a panelist format or a town hall meeting format, which I love the town hall meeting format because that's when actual people can ask questions to the candidates.
Yep. I think the town hall will be very interesting in this particular debate, more so than any of the others.
What kind of questions do you think are going to be directed towards Trump? Because there's a lot of people that hate him, and vice versa with Biden. There's a lot of people. Yes. There are so many people that are on Team Trump or Team Biden, and it's so strong. I mean, you can't get them off of those teams at all. So what kind of questions do you think are going to be targeted towards those guys?
I really hope that people are going to take this serious, and it's not going to be just a massacre of either party, and people are going to go in and have constructed comprehensive questions that can be answered, because you've got a golden opportunity. You're one of a very few that get to go and actually ask a direct question to our POTUS or our potential new POTUS. So I just hope that they're good, strong questions.
Exactly. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back for our second segment. But I forgot to mention at the top of the hour, we have a special guest coming on the show at 4:30. And I'm going to be quite honest with you, Amber. I'm nervous about speaking to this guest because of how much power he has. He is a sitting circuit court judge, and he is running for re-election in November. David Allen Barber from Rowan County will be on the show joining us via Zoom. I'm excited to talk to him.
Very excited.
But ladies and gentlemen, that's coming up at 4:30. Stick with us. We got lots more Off the Cuff coming at you live right after these words. Stick with us.
Buddy, you're a boy, make a big noise, playing in the street, gonna be a big man someday. You got mud on your face, you big disgrace, kicking your can all over the place, singing.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also joining me. We are in the postseason of a lot of sports, the NBA being one of them. The NBA kicked off yesterday with the two teams being the LA Lakers versus the Miami Heat. Amber, the Lakers, I feel like, are in the playoffs a ton. As a matter of fact, they are making, well, it says here that they're looking for their 17th championship. It doesn't say how many times they've been to the finals. I just know that they've been to the finals a ton of times. I know for a while it was always either the Lakers or the Celtics, back and forth, back and forth.
Yeah, I know. And, you know, I don't watch much basketball, professional NBA, and I tell you, I feel like I always hear the Lakers more than anybody else.
But they are back in the finals. It's their first final appearance since 2010, so it's been 10 years since they have been in the finals. I was actually watching that while I was a student at Morehead State. I was watching it at Buffalo Wild Wings, and I'll never forget that team. It was such a great team to watch, too. Lamar Odom was on that team.
Oh, come on.
And, man, Kobe.
Speaking of, you think he's going to make a last appearance on the last season of Keeping Up with the Kardashians?
I don't know. I just keep seeing him pop up on my Facebook timeline about him trying to beat porn addiction. So I don't know if that's bad because that's popping up on my timeline or the fact that Lamar Odom has a porn addiction problem. But yes, the Lakers are back in the finals since 2010. Of course, Kobe Bryant led that team to a world championship, and it's something. 2020 is the year that Kobe Bryant died, and 2020 is going to be the year that the Lakers win their 17th championship, because the Lakers, I think, are going to win this game in four.
Are you going to give your over-under?
My over-under for that? Mm-hmm. Let me see here what I can do for y'all on the over-under. So, looks like the over-under is set at 217.5. Take the under. I think that when you're in playoff games, the scoring isn't going to be ridiculous like it usually is. I mean, there may be a little bit more defense than usual during an NBA playoff game. Because I could go on a soapbox about how the NBA is in its darkest times ever right now. Because the NBA, it's terrible. You try to watch it, it's not entertaining. What's entertaining about watching these athletes go up and score 50, 60, 70 points and not get guarded? I mean, you see Tyler Hero scoring 50, 60 points a game. He wasn't doing that at college.
No.
He didn't do that at college. You know why? It's because they guarded him in college. It's not a coincidence that Tyler Hero and Devin Booker and people like that are always scoring 50, 60, 70 points a game, and they didn't in college. People say, well, they got better. No, they didn't. They don't guard you in NBA. So quit saying they got better. They don't guard you. So I don't see what's entertaining about that. It's just a bunch of guys with over it. Inflated egos about how good they are and how talented they are, and they could really care less if they win a championship or not. So I do. I don't think the NBA has always been like this. Mm-hmm. That's why I say we're having the darkest days of the NBA right now, and the coronavirus didn't help it any.
Well, won't you tell us how you really feel about the NBA?
I've talked about LeBron James before on the show, but he's... Say what you want to about him. He is a phenomenal athlete. Mm-hmm. This will be LeBron James' 10th career appearance in the finals, and he now is in great company, joining Bill Russell and Sam Jones. Bill Russell had 12, Sam Jones had 11. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar had 10. And those are the only players that went to the NBA Finals that many times. LeBron won two titles, one in 2012 and one in 2013, and went to four consecutive finals with the Miami Heat, as a matter of fact, from 2011 to 2014. So LeBron is searching for his third title, or I'm sorry, he is searching for his fourth title. He's won three, and I think that when you win three, I think people can stop saying, oh, well, he's not great. I think three kind of solidifies that you're great. Four, it puts you in a whole nother ball game.
Yes, it does.
Yeah, and so Miami Heat, they're making its first trip to the finals since LeBron James left, and they're powered by Jimmy Butler and Bam Adebayo and Tyler Hero.
Oh.
But two UK guys, Hero and Bam Adebayo, not big fans of either of those two. People are like, oh, Adam, they played for UK. They played for UK for a year. Stop it.
If you go back and listen to the Off the Cuff archives,
you'll
very clearly hear that we have always not been Tyler Hero fans.
I mean,
I think
people,
we've made that very clear.
People will stop here at UK, and they'll play for a year, and then people expect you to follow their entire professional career. No, I honestly don't think they care about UK. They came here. It was their one-stop shop to get a faster trip to the NBA plan under Cal. I don't really think they bleed blue just because they played here. So, no, I'm not really a fan, and no, I'm not rooting for Bam Adebayo. Or am I rooting for Tyler Hero? And let me just say this, too, about LeBron James. I do think he's great. Mm-hmm. And I don't want people to start sitting here thinking, oh, well, I told you so. I told you so. Hey, MJ's still better. MJ's still the GOAT. I don't care if he wins four. MJ still got six. I don't care. MJ is still the GOAT of basketball. So yes, the NBA playoffs has officially began. The next game is tomorrow, and they play on ABC, and I believe the game starts at 9 o'clock. So game two, I think that the Lakers will take it in four. Though the MLB playoffs, hence my red shirt that I have on, the playoffs kicked off, and it consisted of 16 teams. Now, a lot of teams are already out of it, Amber. Let me just give you an update on the playoffs, because the playoffs are currently going on. The Dodgers versus the Brewers. The Dodgers is up 1-0. They play tonight at 10 o'clock. Braves versus Reds. The Reds are out of it. Unfortunately, they played their last game today.
Oh, no.
Cubs versus Marlins. Marlins is up 1-0. It got rained out the game today. Padres versus Cardinals. The Cardinals is up 1-0. That game is again tonight at 7 o'clock. That's the National League. Over here in the American League, you have Rays versus Blue Jays. The Rays won. Athletics versus White Sox. They're in game three. They're 1-1 right now. Twins versus Astros. The Astros won that one. And Cleveland versus Yankees. And the Yankees won that one. Five networks will be splitting the broadcast duties throughout the 2020 playoffs. ESPN, TBS will split the wild card series. MLB Network, TBS, and FS1 will share the division series. And Fox, FS1 will get the NLCS, while TBS gets the ALCS, with the World Series airing on Fox per usual. So that, ladies and gentlemen, is the playoffs of sports. Sports is finally back in full swing.
How long have you been waiting to say that?
A long, long time. But ladies and gentlemen, it's now that time for Off the Cuff to take its Song of the Week break. I'm very excited to play the song. I was actually reminded of how good this song was when I heard it on an episode of Family Matters that I was watching the other day. So sit back, relax, and we'll be right back after the song, because we got Judge David Allen Barber coming up after the song. We'll be right back. Now, Amber, if that's not a banger, I don't know what a banger is.
you know, I couldn't help myself but dancing. I'm sure the audience is so tired of me dancing, but you play some bangers.
She's got skills. I don't want to ruin it for people, so there you go. You're welcome. But ladies and gentlemen, like I said, we've got David Allen Barber on the show, and he's going to be joining us via Zoom. But before we take a break, let me just read his bio. David Allen Barber was a justice of the Kentucky Supreme Court from March the 23rd, 2015 to December 2015 for the 7th District. David Barber has been practicing law for years. He was a partner with the law firm of Richardson, Barber, and Williamson in Owingsville, Kentucky. He also served as a policy and legal advisor to House Speaker Greg Stumbo. Barber was a Kentucky Court of Appeals judge from 2000 to 2007. In the early 1990s, Barber was general counsel to the House of Representatives before his appointment as an administrative law judge with the Kentucky Department of Workers' Claims. Early in his legal career, Barber served as the attorney for the City of Martin and the Floyd County School Board and was elected as Floyd County Attorney. David Allen Barber was appointed by Governor Beshear to the 21st Judicial Circuit, 2nd Division Circuit Judge seat, which covers Rowan, Bath, Menifee, and Montgomery counties. It's a big deal. And he is running for that election, running for that same seat against Elizabeth Davis this November. So we're going to be joined by David Allen Barber after the break. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll be right back. Stick with us.
The band was jumping and the drum began to swing. You should have heard the knocked out jailbird sing that roar.
Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you, broadcasting from Lexington, Kentucky in the WLXU studios. Amber is joining me via Zoom. And ladies and gentlemen, I am very happy to be joined by Your Honor, Judge David Allen Barber. David, thank you so much for being a guest on Off the Cuff.
Well, thanks, guys, for inviting me. Glad to participate.
Well, I have to ask you, David, how does such a powerful guy like yourself stay so humble?
Well, you know, to be honest with you, Adam, I come from a family of, believe it or not, the Bankses, just like you, and we're a very large family. I was the youngest of the oldest grandchild, but raised a lot by my grandparents. And when you're at the bottom of the pecking order, you learn to be humble. It serves you much better.
Absolutely. And one of the things I was reading about you, David, was that I found impressive was you studied speech communication in school in your bachelor's degree and your master's degree. So did you ever flirt with the idea of going into broadcasting?
No, I've got, as you can tell, I've got a very unusual voice with an Eastern Kentucky twang. And I can tell you in law school and on the bench, people thought I was the janitor, didn't really know I was a law student or a lawyer until you start writing it down on paper. So then they want to borrow your outlines.
So, David, you were first appointed by Andy Beshear to this seat that you're sitting in now. Can you explain to the audience what goes into the governor picking you over everybody else? What goes into an appointment?
Well, that's a good question, Adam. It's actually you're vetted by a group of bipartisan, half Democrats, half Republicans. And then the top three candidates are selected by that group of citizens and lawyers and the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. If you make the top three, then the governor, whether it's a Democrat or Republican, looks at the credentials. You know, I had been a judge for many, many years. This is the first time I've actually been a trial judge. I had been on the Supreme Court and on the Court of Appeals, so it's kind of the reverse order. I think that the governor just, we were going through a bit of a crisis in my jurisdiction. The circuit judge had been suspended for 2 years, and we had judges filling in. And, of course, as you know, their priorities are not necessarily with your area, and everything was getting kind of kicked down the road, like kicking the can. And so I think the governor looked at my qualifications and my experience and hopefully a little bit about my demeanor and chose me over the other two that was selected by the group?
Well, I know that you did run in the election during the primary, and it was pretty close. Your opponent, Elizabeth Davis, you beat her by around 300 to 400 votes, but you still won. And you're going up against her again. So tell us, what makes you the better person for this job?
Experience. It's all about judicial experience, Adam. There is, it's a question. If you were going to have brain surgery tomorrow, would you want your surgeon to be someone who had successfully performed the surgery hundreds of times?
Oh, my gosh, yes.
Someone that this was going to be your first.
Hundreds of times.
My opponent's never judged at all. She worked for a little while as assistant prosecutor. You know, I guess Amber will tell you, I was the elected prosecutor at home for a number of years prior to going on the bench. So I would say that in the troubled times that we're having with this pandemic, as well as our particular circumstance in my jurisdiction of having special judges for 2 years, that it takes someone with that kind of background to guide us through the situation as it exists. I had spent the last couple years after leaving the Supreme Court being a special judge all over Eastern Kentucky, and I can honestly tell you that the Chief Justice told me I was the most requested special judge. So that's flattering. I'm not trying to blow my own whistle, but it's flattering when you serve someplace and they ask for you to come back.
Well, let me ask you this, David. So sometimes, you know, and Amber can vouch for me here, I've been critical of judges for certain rulings that they've had on this show. Do you get anybody ever harassing you over a ruling you made? And I mean, like, have you ever received death threats or anything like that? I mean, how do you cope with feeling safe after making some of these critical judgments that you have to make?
Well, you just have to have the grit in your crawl to do it. You know, I honestly fear more for my family. You know, I'm a big boy. I knew what I signed on for years ago. And yes, I have had many threats made, both as a prosecutor and again as a judge. Probably the most criticism I ever got was when I was on the appellate court. You know, being young and naive, I was going to go to the Circuit Judges Judicial College, Adam, and my colleague said, "No, don't do that. You're reversing those guys." And sure enough, man, that weekend they harangued me over rulings I made. But if you follow the law and follow the Constitution and kind of have a moral compass, a Christian-based compass, you eventually will come to the right conclusion.
Have you ever made a ruling that you have regretted or you have felt like you made the wrong ruling later on?
I've made rulings that I didn't like, but honestly, it was because I was following the law. Sometimes the law is crafted by the legislature to fit situations that I personally don't necessarily agree with, but I've taken an oath to follow the law. So, yeah, there are times I say I wish I could, and have stated that in opinions. It said that I wish that this weren't the law and that urged the legislature to reconsider. But as long as it is a law, I've taken an oath to follow it.
Well, let me ask you this, too. You've served as a justice on the Supreme Court, so I think that you're a pretty credible guy to talk about this with. Casino gambling here in Kentucky is illegal, but yet we have the Red Mile. And I've said this to Amber before, if that's not a casino, I don't know what is, because there's slot machines everywhere. How do they get away with having something like the Red Mile in Kentucky if it's... It looks like a duck and quacks like a duck. You know what I mean?
Well, in an effort to try to fund education, we passed the lottery bill years ago. It was successful because, as you know, a large part of it was designed to go towards education. And many people have gotten to go to college who otherwise would not have been able to because of that funding mechanism. The horse industry is a very strong lobby in Kentucky and successfully stymied gaming outside of their bailiwick, so to speak. And it's because, you know, there's only so many gambling dollars to go around. And if they start, if the industry starts splitting it with casinos, then it leaves their purses smaller. It has an erosion effect. I really can't tell you that there is a, to me, it's a distinction without a difference. But I believe that we could have used the opportunity several years ago to instituted a sunset gas tax and a penny or two on the sales tax and casino gambling to have fully funded our pensions. You know, the pension situation is one that prior to COVID has taken a whole lot of press, and because it is in a dire situation, and we had a mechanism to be able to deal with that, but because of the groups whose interests were outside of gambling, was able to successfully avoid that. And now our pensions are in such shape that we wish we had hindsight rather, or had foresight rather than hindsight.
Yes, I think that if I think that is the key, but hey, I'm not in power to make those decisions. But I would like to see one day casino gambling to come into Kentucky. But I just wanted to ask that. Thank you for.
Well, and it bothers me as it does you for those gambling dollars. You know, our people just go across the river to one of the other states and spend their money, and we're sitting here with our pockets turned inside out, saying, "Please,
please, you know, yeah."
Common sense should prevail, but it doesn't always.
Well, I'm glad to hear someone else shares that too. Well, why I still have you, will you just tell our audience why they need to go out and vote for you? I know you mentioned your experience, but real quick, while you have the Lexington airwaves listening to you and with our app, hopefully people in your areas that you serve, tell us why they need to go out to the polls in November or online to vote David Allen Barber for judge.
That's a good question. And again, it's very... humbling to me and I'm not real good, as you can tell, at blowing my own horn. I got an opinion about everything usually, but it's hard for me to ask people to donate to me or to vote for me. I tell those people who have questions about my credentials that I'm an open book. I've written many opinions that have been, that are published, that are very strongly pro-education, pro-worker, but I'm basically considered a moderate or moderate to conservative. So if you want someone who knows the law and has the empathy and compassion to be able to listen, you know, a lot of times judges get robitis. You know, we get so full of ourselves that we can't really appreciate the situation. I found that if you just shut your mouth and listen, the person who's in front of you has very real concerns. They may not be big concerns for you, but they're big to them. So once you understand what their problem is, you can usually use the law to get to what is the best result with the law and the people. So, yeah, you know, I think that just plays back into what I said before. Experience on the bench is everything. Not everyone should be a judge, to be honest with you. It's hard to sentence someone to the electric chair. It's hard to sign a death warrant on the Supreme Court. But if you follow the law and follow your oath, you do what you have to do.
Well, last question. So you have been a part of many elections. Do you have any rituals that you do on election days to keep your nerves calm? Because I worked on a campaign before, and I know on election day I was tore all to pieces because waiting on those results to come in can be, oh my gosh, it can be, it could take a toll on you. So do you do anything, or what do you do on election day to keep your mind just off of the polls for a second or two?
Remember the old commercial that says you can't let them see you sweat. My first election, my aunts Amber's mother, my grandmother, they're all there, and they're a nervous wreck. If I had acted distraught, then they would have fallen apart. So now that I've got my grandkids and my children who are sitting there looking to me for leadership, I can't show them that type of emotion. I have to be the rock that they lean on.
Right.
So, yeah, your insides is kind of like butterflies, but on the outside, you're just stoic.
Whew, I don't know how you do it, but I do wish you the best of luck in November. Thank you so much for coming on Off the Cuff and speaking with us. That's David Allen Barber, ladies and gentlemen, running for circuit court judge this November in the counties of Rowan, Bath, Menifee, and Montgomery counties. David, thanks again.
Thank you all. Thanks, Amber.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back after these words. Stick with us. Welcome back, everybody, to Off the Cuff. Adam Banks here with you. Amber is also broadcasting with me. I'm pretty sure that I was on the air during the commercial break, so I apologize if I came across the airwaves, but Amber, that wasn't as bad as what I thought it was going to be. I made it through without stumbling over my words speaking to a judge.
Yeah, I think you did really well.
I really do like this guy. Now, do you know him personally?
I do know him personally, and, you know, I think it kind of speaks to his testament as just who he is as a person. You know, I know with his campaign, he does talk about being very pro-family and a family-oriented man, and I do have to say David is a close cousin of mine, and in times of need growing up, I think the audience is very familiar with my background. David opened not only his heart but his home several times to me, so I am a true testament to he really is family oriented and cares about, you know, when he was speaking about empathy and sympathy, he sincerely has that. But yeah, David's a cousin, and I'm real proud of him.
I know. I think that was pretty cool. So I really do appreciate him coming on the show.
And he's a Banks.
And he's a Banks. I didn't know that.
Yes. I feel like we've talked about that several times.
But David is trying to get reelected into his seat. Donald Trump is trying to get reelected into his seat. Joe Biden's trying to get elected into Trump's seat. But they are vying, Amber, Trump and Biden. They're vying to get in that famous big White House, the White House where the president lives. And, you know, I get a little jealous when I hear about students who have visited the White House for their senior trip, because I never got to do anything like that when I was in high school. Did you?
You know, I did. We went to high school together.
It was terrible, though. But did your parents visit the White House their senior year of school?
Probably not. I mean, my parents were from the same county I was from, and I don't really think they had much money then, just like they don't now, but no, I don't think so.
And I think they were giving tours of the White House. They were given tours that it was a lot less, it was more lax than what it is today, because that was pre-9/11 and all that good stuff. But yeah, the White House. So, Amber, before we go here, I have some White House facts to tell to the audience. Okay. Some things that you might have not even known about the White House, and probably didn't, because we never have been there before. But it's a fascinating place to live, and a lot of people just see it on Pennsylvania Avenue, and they're like, oh, well, that's pretty identifiable.
That's a nice house.
That's where the president lives.
Nice house.
Well, Amber, there are 132 rooms, 32 bathrooms, six levels to accommodate all the people who work, live, and visit the White House. I mean, I've been looking for a three-bedroom house.
Yeah.
I don't know what I would do with 132 rooms.
What would you do with 32 toilets? I wouldn't have enough time in the day to clean all my toilets.
There are also 412 doors, 147 windows, 28 fireplaces, 7 staircases, and 3 elevators. At various times in history, the White House has been known as the President's Palace, the President's House, and the Executive Mansion. I'm actually surprised that we don't call it that anyway. I think that's much cooler than the White House. I mean,
wait,
I think
which one of those three did you like better?
Ooh, I like President's Palace.
Not President's Pad. That would be chill.
President's Pad. I mean, does pad mean palace? Is that like slang for palace?
Pad? Well, I think pad, like bachelor pad, but
President Theodore Roosevelt officially gave the White House its current name in 1901, so it was you, Teddy, that gave it that ridiculous name. It sounds like a third grader gave it that name. Well, it's white. Let's call it the White House.
Down there at the White House.
With people from Eastern Kentucky, they say White House. And I can say that because I'm from Eastern Kentucky. So before I get any hate mail from Eastern Kentuckians, the White House, it says it has full-time chefs. The White House has a kitchen that's able to serve as many 140 guests. The White House requires 570 gallons of paint to cover its outside surface.
That's a lot of paint.
For recreation, the White House has a variety of facilities available to its residents, including a tennis court, a jogging track, a swimming pool, a movie theater, a billiard room, and a bowling lane. So, okay. And I think a lot of presidents, too, because that's where they live at, I think that they, some way, somehow, they incorporate the president's hobby into the White House. So I know that Obama, sure, he loved basketball, so he played a lot on the presidential basketball court, which I'm not for sure if they built that for him. I'm assuming that since basketball is such a common sport to play, I'm assuming that it was already in existence.
Well, wouldn't it in the first kid? Didn't he play basketball in the first kid?
Oh, he did. That is right. So, I guess you're right. It says, today, the White House includes rooms for the president and his family, offices, guest rooms, a library, and a china room. These rooms are not open to the public. If you visit the White House, you can see the East Room, the Oval Blue Room, the Green Room, the Red Room, and the State Dining Room, which is used for formal dinners. And the reason they name these rooms by the color is because that's mm-hmm. what color the room is decorated in. But there you go.
What about if you want to change the color in the room? You have to change the whole name.
You have to change the whole name. And I think the First Lady has a lot to do with the decor of the White House.
I will say that Melania Trump has decorated very beautifully for all holidays that she has been in the White House.
She has. She's done a really good job for it. Camp David, Amber, is also something really cool. Camp David, do you know what Camp David is?
Go ahead and tell us, thanks.
Well, Camp David is the country's getaway spot. Camp David is where the president goes to chill. It is in the mountains. It's in, help me out here. Somebody on the show thread, where is Camp David? Because I had it written down here, now I can't find it. But I think it's in one of these states, like it's in the mountains. I'll just say that.
North Carolina.
No, it's not North Carolina, but it's like a retreat. It's his getaway. It's like a little, it's got a very cabinish feel. It's got lots of place to hike and just mm-hmm. to be around nature, because the president has to have something like that because his life is chaotic 24/7.
Yeah.
So Camp David is his place to go and chill. And a lot of the times, the president usually lets his staff use it for he lets his staff take their family to Camp David and hang out for the weekend. The only president that has never used Camp David since its existence is Donald Trump. Because Donald Trump says, you know how long you'll like Camp David? For about 30 minutes. That's what he says.
Truth now, Woody.
All right, but he goes to his own location. He has his own location that he goes to hangs out because he's a billionaire. He can do that. He probably has a place that makes Camp David look like the Carr Creek Lake in Knott County. Again, I can say that I'm from there, which I love the lake. It's very beautiful in Knott County. But ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you for listening to another episode of Off the Cuff. We are now on Instagram. You can follow Off the Cuff on Facebook and Insta at Off the Cuff with Adam Banks. You can follow me, the host, at The Adam Banks on all social media platforms. You can follow Amber, the co-host, on all social media platforms at Ambu447. You can listen to all of our previous episodes by downloading Off the Cuff on podcast on iTunes, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever podcast streaming is available. We are live every Thursday from 4 to 5 right here on WLXU. Ladies and gentlemen, that is Amber Turner. I'm Adam Banks, and this is Off the Cuff. We'll see you next Thursday from 4 to 5.